The Movie Preview Critic. Informing and entertaining your movie world.
Could we pick up now where we left off? Mr. Stark, please.
Yes, dear.
Can I have your attention?
Absolutely.
Can I just say, I love this movie already. How awesome is it that the world knows the identity of a superhero? When is the last time we saw that on the big screen? One of the great things about the first Iron Man was this holy s*** ending.
I am Iron Man.
And I love that the continuity here is picking up right where the last one left off. So let's cross that off of our things to worry about in the sequel list. These others can be crossed off as well, because director Jon Favreau returns behind the camera and in front, playing Stark's chauffeur. Robert Downey Jr., having one of the greatest career comebacks in movie history, returns as Tony Stark. Gwyneth Paltrow is Pepper Potts again, bringing along with her awesome relationship chemistry.
Go get him, boss.
You complete me.
This is becoming easily one of the best romantic tension-filled will they become lovers or just stay friends relationships in comic book movie history. The only major change here is Don Cheadle replacing Terrence Howard as Colonel James Rhodes. Whatever the behind-the-scenes bull contract reasons for this, I like it. Look at Don here. He just has more of a badass persona. And check this out. I can buy Don as War Machine way more than I could Terrence, who is a great actor, but, as is apparent now, was just not right for this part. The writer here is actually actor-turned-screenwriter Justin Theroux, crafting the story along with the uncredited help of Jon Favreau and Robert Downey Jr., who actually got Justin the job here after working with him on Tropic Thunder. It's time for warning sign number 71. The screenwriter does not have an extensive and/or impressive resume. Not the most extreme warning, but something to be aware of. I'll give Justin the benefit of the doubt because so far he's batting 1,000, having written Tropic Thunder. And it sure seems like the comedy spirit from that movie is carrying over here.
I have successfully privatized world peace.
We're adjourned for the day. You've been a delight.
Tony Stark may just be my favorite superhero in human form. He doesn't take things too seriously, is a little cocky, and likes to have fun. Then we're introduced to the bad guy opponent, Mickey Rourke playing Whiplash. And here's when we have to go to the Iron Man comic book mythology to crack the code of this preview and reveal its story secrets. Without getting too geeked out on who's who in the comic universe versus the movies, here in the film, Whiplash is going to be Ivan Vanko, son of Anton Vanko, who was Crimson Dynamo. That doesn't really match the comics, but for the purposes of the movie, it's gonna work fine. The next piece of the puzzle is that Iron Man 2 will be influenced by the 9-issue story arc in 1979, known as Demon in a Bottle, which dealt with Stark's battle with alcoholism. The use of this story follows a popular sequel pattern in Hollywood, where the second movie in a trilogy usually gets emotionally deeper and takes the characters to a darker, challenging place. And this makes perfect sense, since the first movie in a trilogy spends most of its energy introducing the characters, the universe, the rules, and the overall conflict. The motivation for Tony to go down this road is that in the Demon in the Bottle storyline, there's an accident that he feels responsible for. This increases his drinking, which was hinted at in the original movie. And we can see here in this shot, it seems that Tony is wondering how long he has to live. This energy source device in his chest is just buying him time. It's not a permanent solution. This leads him to question his mortality. And as Iron Man fans know, this is when in the comics, War Machine steps in and fills Iron Man's shoes as Tony is in rehab. So the question for us is, how does Colonel James Rhodes go from sitting next to Tony here to fighting side by side with him here? Most likely Rhodes will be given the War Machine suit while Tony tries to get his act together somewhere around the middle of the movie. Now we also have to factor in, along with Whiplash attacking Tony, there's going to be a threat from S.H.I.E.L.D. as they pressure Stark to share his technology, which is pretty great news. Expect the Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. to have bigger roles in this movie. Of course Samuel L. Jackson is back as Nick Fury. We get a glimpse of him in this scene here, which seems to have a real heart-to-heart serious tone. My guess is that this is Tony over here, and he's trying to give Stark some advice or a pep talk to motivate him back into the superhero game. And can we just agree right now that not many actors would be able to pull off this eye patch in such a badass way? Scarlett Johansson is Natasha Romanoff, aka Black Widow, another SHIELD agent who here is undercover as Stark's assistant, replacing Pepper Potts, who moves up into the CEO spot of Stark Industries, a position that belonged to Obadiah Stane before his betrayal in the first movie. Let's just take a guess that SHIELD's motivation in placing Black Widow as Stark's assistant is to gain control of Stark Industries, or at the very least to find out the secrets of the Iron Man technology so they can make their own versions, since the government can't legally take it from Stark.
We're safe. America is secure. You want my property? You can't have it!
That leaves us wondering about this moment here. Are these Iron Man wannabe robots the creation of SHIELD, or has Whiplash made them? They do have the same power cores, and look very Iron Man-ish. One more thing to note. This guy here, played by Sam Rockwell, is Justin Hammer. In the comics, he's a bit older, and an enemy of Stark after his company loses a bit to Stark Industries. This motivates a revenge plot which drives the main narrative of the Demon in a Bottle storyline in the comics. Even though currently his role in the movie is being downplayed, there's a chance that he's the one funding or forcing Whiplash to destroy Tony. Also in the movie, Paul Bettany is back as the voice of Jarvis, Greg Clark is back as SHIELD agent Phil Coulson, and Stan Lee will have yet another cameo. So putting all these pieces together, expect Act 1 to set up the conflict of Act 2 by establishing Stark as a pop culture phenomenon in a world where everyone knows his identity, the same world where SHIELD would prefer knowledge about superheroes to be kept a secret. After Stark refuses to give the government his technology, SHIELD sends Black Widow in to find out his secrets. At the same time, Hammer enlists Whiplash to destroy Stark. At the end of Act 1, some kind of accident happens that sends Tony into a self-destructive drinking frenzy. In Act 2, Whiplash captures Tony, and this is where we get this long speech.
Like one guilty man, you tried to rewrite your own history.
He's talking to Stark. Most likely, he has him hostage. At this point, Pepper Potts, now in control of Stark Industries in Tony's absence, decides to give Colonel James Rhodes control of a prototype suit dubbed War Machine. Somewhere here, Black Widow invades Stark Industries and steals the Iron Man technology, and SHIELD begins to build their own version. Act 2 will also develop the theme for Tony, where he deals with his struggle to grow old and emotionally dealing with his unspoken love for Pepper Potts. Apparently, she's engaged to some guy. But you gotta wonder, Stark is a playboy and has dealt with a lot of women, so why can't he tell this one how he feels about her? Regarding Tony's escape from Whiplash, it's not really clear how that's gonna happen, but expect Whiplash should probably have some kind of redemption as he dies in Act 3, and Iron Man and War Machine to join up and fight the wannabe Iron Man robots. The movie ends with Whiplash and Hammer neutralized, and most importantly, SHIELD and Tony working together, which sets up an Avengers movie, which is being developed for May 4th, 2012 release date. That means the Avengers will come out before Iron Man 3. Wow. It's definitely an exciting time to be a comic book fan. When it was first announced back in 2007 that John Swingers Favreau was going to direct Iron Man, I was one of the skeptics. He had nowhere near the writing or directing experience and results of Christopher Nolan or Sam Raimi. But on May 2nd, 2008, he proved himself to us all. And it looks like with Iron Man 2, he's gonna erase any lingering doubts. The most reassuring thing is that his heart and filmmaking spirit are in the right place, as he continues to balance the marketing needs of the studio with the story adaptation dreams of the audience. So let's just add his name to the select list of filmmakers who know how to make movies based in character that deliver on genre and, most importantly, give a about us, the audience. Oh, and one more thing. The movie's soundtrack is also AC/DC's greatest hits. As much as that's an obvious marketing gimmick, the music actually goes really well with the imagery, which makes it official. Iron Man 2 is gonna rock. The movie Movie Preview Critic rates Iron Man 2 worthy of big screen viewing. See it as a midnight show. The preview definitely makes you say, holy f***ing that looks awesome. It stimulates imagination, exists because of the trilogy syndrome, the pre-existing fan base guarantees box office, it's a fanboy requirement, and makes for a perfect guy's night out. You'll see it because you like the story, actors, action movie, CGI, comic book adaptations, and it's definitely a sign of movie hope. The budget here is about $210 million, which is $70 more than the first. That installment made $102 opening weekend, and eventually, worldwide, totaled $572. There's no reason to think Iron Man 2 won't open bigger. And to compare sequels, The Dark Knight made $158 opening weekend, and it's safe to say that movie was way more anticipated. So let's say that this one here is going to make between $100 to $120 million opening weekend, with a worldwide total of $700. As for Iron Man place in movie history, it should be better than the first Iron Man, but not better than X-Men 2. Until next time, choose your movies wisely, because Hollywood gives us more of what we pay for, and as always,
long live good movies!